Okay.
It's March.
It's March.
Welcome.
And like a lion, out like a lamb.
And this is Bedford Common.
And this is Bedford
and
Common.
And it's on, we're on now. Welcome to Bedford Common.
So that's straight.
Okay.
Hi,
I'm
hello,
Ralph Hammond.
How are you?
This
you
is
go.
My co-host, Julie Turner.
And these are our guests.
The best ones. Who do we have? Let's start with Ben. What does Ben do?
Ben's on the finance committee.
Oh, finance committee,
yes.
Ben. And the next one is Sean, who's on the
planning board.
And then Margaret, oh man, I keep forgetting, she's on so many committees.
There you go. Well, we're
Board of Selectmen Committee.
No, not the, just the Selectmen.
Oh, the Selectmen Committee.
Anymore.
They're not
yeah.
bored?
We're not
I'd be bored if
boring.
I talked to them. And Ann is in the school on the school committee.
Yes.
Yeah.
But not chair.
No.
Get out of that. You're lucky.
Yeah.
Okay, so what are we up to? What are we going to do?
Well, first of all, we are going to tell Margot and Sean, thank you very much for being with us this year, because there will be a town election between now and the time we do this again, and someone else will be chair, and
sure.
so we will have a new planning board person and
oh,
a
really?
New selectman.
Yep,
oh,
this is our last time.
No.
I think Ben is going to stay as chair of the finance committee, and you will
not be, but I'll still be the television person.
You'll be the
person.
Television okay. person.
We actually will talk about it, but there's
okay.
a likelihood I may stay.
All so. Right, well, we will miss you if you leave, as we will miss Sean and Margot. You have been great guests.
So we're going to miss you. Sean, too? You switch?
We switch, and thank you both for, I've really enjoyed it. It's one of my favorite things as chair to be on the show.
We like hearing that. We do. So what's going on? Are there town elections coming up? Is there a town meeting?
Are these leading questions?
Yes.
Sort of.
No.
Yeah.
That's fine.
So how's the finance committee ready for town meeting?
Well, we've been incredibly busy since the last time I was on the show. We've taken positions on a lot of the articles. We haven't finished all the articles. We're going to finish those up in the next couple of weeks. And then we switch into a phase, and we're starting it tonight, of writing up, as you well know, writing up positions on the articles so the voters will have some written information as to how we were thinking about our positions before they get to town meeting.
And I would have to say, having been in the audience, the number of times I saw people having printed out your comments, the Finance Committee comments, and referring back to them was quite heartening. So yeah. know that it is well used.
Well, thank you. We're really pleased about that. It was a pilot last time, so effort went in, but we weren't sure where the sweet spot was, so we're going to try and turn the dial up a few notches this time, perhaps a little more detailed information, and see if we can find the sweet spot for information and, you know, curing insomnia.
is that information going to be
Both
online
goals,
prior
Ben.
To the meeting?
Both.
Can we do that?
It will. Well, we intend to get it into the Minuteman, the Citizen, and on the town web pages. So
okay.
It will be the goal is to be available for Minuteman print deadline, so that's at least a week before town meeting, and then we usually print up, 400 or 500 copies, I don't remember how many Victor printed last time,
right.
for town meeting.
To hand out at the...
Yeah.
So people can
register
see it before and during.
Perfect.
Right, and it's absolutely wonderful. It
well,
gives a
yeah.
perspective and a depth that voters need.
We're trying.
There
Our town
go.
Really does things nicely. Yep.
If you had to pick a favorite, no, you don't want to do that. Never mind. I'm not going to ask.
Depends
you.
Upon a favorite what?
It's a favorite article.
Favorite article coming up this year.
They're all special.
They're all going to be good.
They
this
are
year.
Absolutely.
They're all my favorite children.
There you
yeah.
go. Exactly. So, Margot, the selectman. Do you have a favorite article?
Well, you know, there's a lot that goes into putting together a town meeting warrant, and obviously with the budget, that's the big thing that we absolutely have to do. And then I think, as we said last time, there were some housekeeping articles, and those are, you know, they're fine. You know, we get them done. We want to make sure that our bylaws are consistent with our practice, and I think the new sewer connection fees, that's an example of something that will be, you know, uncontroversial and pretty simple and quick. And then we'll have bigger subjects. I know Sean is going to talk about the zoning articles. And then we have exciting projects that people are waiting for with bated breath, such as the Davis Road Boardwalk,
yes.
Which I anticipate there should be a good turnout for. And obviously, Anne will talk about the schools project. But I would like to lift up a couple of the items on the agenda and just give you the selectmen's perspective on sort of how we got to have these things going on. And number one is the Pine Hill Road rezoning. People who came to town meeting last fall know that that initial zoning package didn't go through. And there was some work that needed to be done, and Sean can tell you all the the nitty-gritty of the details of the changes and the things that they did on the planning board.
And that's the Pine Hill Crossing.
The Pine Hill Crossing zoning, okay. And this is military reuse zoning that we're going to be hopefully adopting. But I just wanted to give some historical perspective because a lot of people don't know how long the town has actually been working on making this happen. I wasn't even a selectman yet when those homes became vacant. Right. And that's my part of the woods. That's my neighborhood. And so it was very disconcerting to see those homes
sitting there empty.
Sitting empty when you knew that there were people who could use a decent, modest home to live in. And so almost immediately, once it became apparent that those homes were going to be no longer used by the Coast Guard, people started asking and inquiring and said, well, why are they empty? And why can't people buy them? And why can't we do something with that property? And it was kind of a fortuitous moment. A couple of selectmen ran into the captain of the Coast Guard at the base holiday party. And we wound up setting up a meeting between the town and the Coast Guard high officials to start this process. That must have been 2013, 2014.
Yeah, a long time ago.
It was a very arduous process to get that property, wrest that property out of the control of the federal government. And I just want to put into perspective, we have a lot of land in town that is owned either by the federal government or the state or a state agency. And here's an opportunity to take a piece of property and not only give those homes or provide homes to people who would like to have them, but generate tax revenue because that property was off the rolls. That was sort of invisible to our taxation. And it was a project that was sitting there that required us to put so many pieces in place over such a long period of time, starting with those initial conversations with the Coast Guard and then reaching out to the General Services Administration. There were phone calls to our senator, our congressman, and a lot of interventions along the way that happened behind the scenes that, you know, and you wouldn't know, right? So finally, when the town was able to come up with this Municipal Affordable Housing Trust project that would kind of be the midwife to this new this new little pocket neighborhood, as it's called, the selectmen really were involved from the beginning and really feel a great deal of pride and ownership in this project.
And glee.
There are moments you don't have glee until something is done. You don't have, Julie, you don't have glee.
You have
cautious optimism.
No, when you finally got the thing sort of where you kind of knew it was going to go.
There may have been a woohoo at some point.
All right, I'll
grant you that.
But then
you know, from that point, people rolled up their sleeves,
and there's a lot of
countless
work.
Staff and hours. Between the town manager's office, the Municipal Affordable Housing Trust, the planning board, and we realize it's not everybody's cup of tea, right? It's not going to be everyone's thing. They might not want to live there, but there are people who do want to live there. And I continue to walk my dog through that part of town and meet people who are excited and interested to know what's going to happen next. Obviously, there are concerns. Obviously, there were things to be ironed out in terms of the zoning, but I'm really optimistic that we'll be able to get this done. And I think when it's done and people look at it, they'll realize that, as usual, Bedford is a little bit ahead of the curve on certain things. We always say first for community preservation, first this, first that. And we're not first on this. There are other towns like Concord that have built these little higher density neighborhoods where people really have a chance to interact. It's designed to be senior friendly, multi-generational. There's, you know, going to have accessibility, first floor bedrooms, and a real opportunity to do something different. And we could have let it just become five very large homes. And we had a community, we had a robust community input, we had those workshops that people attended, and people asked us to see if we could come up with something that wasn't five very big homes. And so that's what we've done. So I'm really looking forward to town meeting, and I hope people will come out and will support that article. Yeah. And I know Sean will talk about it more, but you asked me which one was my favorite. It's not my favorite, but I do feel that there's an awful lot on the line in terms of a lot of effort, a lot of hours of time and community outreach that went into that project, and I'm very hopeful about it.
And in reality, it's a 4 or 5 year project, but in fact, dealing with the government, that's pretty fast moving. So you've got a lot of
good
stuff.
Well, I think I might have been here.
You've worked really hard.
I think I might have been here at one point and said, well, it's kind of pie in the sky and it may never happen.
Right.
And it did kind of switch from absolutely impossible to mm-hmm. we're doing it, kind of on a dime. And you have to be a little nimble, and usually local government isn't so nimble. I mean,
not
it's hard
local,
to be
but
nimble,
you're dealing
right?
with the federal
it's
government.
It's hard to be nimble. So I think there's an awful lot to be proud of in
yes,
that
you've
story.
Done work really
tremendous
hard.
Yeah. Yeah.
So then I know Sean will talk about the Great Road business rezoning as well. And I just want to say this is a generational opportunity to change the face of Bedford's business district. And I think you kind of have to think about it in those long-term ways, that this isn't something that's going to happen tomorrow. It's going to be something that unfolds over the next 20 to 50 years. And this is our opportunity to really do something that could be transformative for our community. So I'm also really excited right. about that.
And to be in on the ground floor.
Yeah, well, yes. or yeah, you've got to start somewhere. Yeah. Ground floor is as good as any. And then I just wanted to mention two things, if I may, that are going to be after town meeting, or would you like me to hold on
no,
to that
afterwards?
No,
that's okay. What's going on after town meeting?
I just wanted to highlight two things. One, there is a regional bike share proposal coming out of MAPC, which is our regional planning organization, to do dockless bike share, which this means, like, if you're familiar with Hubway in Boston, where you take a bike and you can borrow it, but then you have to take it back to a certain location and put it in a dock before you're no longer charged for it. This is dockless, so there aren't big, like, bike racks, but they would just be parked in certain locations around town. And there's a proposal moving forward through MAPC to hire two vendors and to launch this in a network that would connect Bedford to Lexington, Arlington, a whole number, MAPC communities, there's a lot of them,
yeah.
but I think about a dozen communities are signing up to create a little system, a little transportation system using bicycles. And it's really exciting and innovative and leveraging a lot of new technologies. 5 years ago, no one had heard of dockless bike share.
This is going to be good.
And now it's like the rage, and other communities across the country have started doing it. And so this would be a one-year pilot program to see if it worked out for Bedford and for our neighboring communities, and if it allowed us to be a little bit more mobile outside of having to get in your car.
At the beginning of June, we have the Bedford Rotary Bicycle Safety Day. There might be an idea to have a table with some information about
yes.
that.
Yes, and if everything goes smoothly,
yeah.
it may launch, this network may launch as early as this summer.
Wow.
So stay
okay.
tuned.
So let's look at all the options.
Right, so and I think it's something that has been sort of percolating away for a little while, but it now seems to be coming together. And then the other thing that's happening is that we're doing a housing study. I think if you remember at town meeting in the fall, we funded some money to hire a consultant to help us figure out what our affordable housing needs. And by affordable, not just sort of income qualified, deed restricted affordable, but generally affordability in Bedford. I think that's something that people realize is starting to be something of a rare and precious thing, are more affordable homes for folks who can't afford the $1 million house. And again, that goes back to why we cared about Pine Hill Crossing, mm-hmm. right? Why we cared about that Coast Guard housing, because that small, modest size, even if it's not deed restricted, is not going to sell for $1 million, right? A little slab on grade house with two bedrooms is not going to be a $1 million house. It might be something for someone who's more working class. And we want to welcome everybody into our community and not just be a place where only affluent people can live. So we're launching this housing study, and we're going to have outreach and workshops and that whole thing. You know, look for meeting announcements, and if you're interested in learning more and participating in the discussion over the next couple of months, there'll be opportunities to hear from townspeople about senior housing or mm-hmm. you know, small scale housing, or preserving our housing stock, or what,
when your kids grow up and go off to college and
right,
get
or,
married, where do we live? We don't want to live in this big
right,
bounce around
right,
house.
Or can the
yep.
kids who grew up in Bedford move
live
home
in town.
Someday, right?
Yep.
So all of the pieces of the conversation are really important, and to
yep.
hear from a broad diversity of stakeholders is super important.
That's cool.
Was there any news on the dog park?
Nope,
no
nothing
changes.
To report.
Yep.
Nope, okay. We're still in, I think they're still in the looking
meeting
at sites. Discussing.
Yes,
yep.
No,
selectmen have not taken any new
correct.
Action. That's it for me.
This is great.
There you go. Well, lead in
to lead
the...
You lead in, Sean.
Yeah, and I'm going to go on a limb. I actually do have favorite articles in town.
All right.
Does they have anything to do with Pine Hill and Great Road zoning?
Yeah, you guessed it.
I'm so
partial to the zoning articles in town meeting for some reason.
There you go.
So let me start with Pine Hill. I want to thank the selectmen and the Municipal Affordable Housing Trust for their work, because I think some people think this was just something that happened recently from the planning board, but it really wasn't. As Margot mentioned, there were a lot of hands put into creating this, including the hands of a lot of regular citizens that came to the charrettes that were held, the two public charrettes, to say what they wanted. So this is the end of a long process, and it will be presented at this town meeting. As Margot had mentioned, it failed to reach the 2/3 at the previous town meeting, so we went back to the drawing board. Fortunately, we had some time to do so. So there's going to be a few things different. For one thing, I think the most significant part is that there'll be a more explanation at town meeting of why we arrived at where we're at, so that people understand that a lot of what went in is really what the public wanted, specifically asked. The fact that they come up with three options out of the public charrette, and then the boards looked at it, and that was narrowed down a little bit, and one of the options that was chosen for the eventual development is literally one of the options right out of the public charrette. So there's going to be a longer explanation at town meeting about that. A couple of other things is that at the fall town meeting, it was presented as if it could be applied generally, that particular zone. This town meeting, we're just to avoid some confusion, we're presenting it as specifically the Pine Hill Overlay District. So some of the ideas may be used later on for different zones, but this particular zone is intended for this very special piece of town. We've beefed up a lot working with Lee Vorderer, the comments, the language on disabilities, and yeah, we're happy about that.
Yeah.
We've changed a few other things like the setback. But overall, it's going to be the same concept. Hopefully, once this passes, people will see you'll have 29 units, little cottage units in that community, and with lots of good access to walking and biking, very good to the narrow gauge trail. And there's going to be four affordable, according to the state standards, affordable housing. So that's somebody that makes less than 75% of the median income of the area. But there's also going to be houses that we don't typically call affordable or may not officially be affordable, but they're certainly underserved in Bedford. So as Margot had mentioned with the housing study, that there is something in between the state mandated affordable, like the 40B, and the mansions that we have in Bedford. Mm-hmm. And of course the market is the market, so we can't dictate price, but by building smaller houses like are being proposed for this particular property, we can get some of the houses around that $500,000 range, where you just don't see that much in Bedford right now. So downsizing seniors are a particular target for this, that would be somebody that's lived in Bedford for a long time that doesn't need that much property but wants to stay in Bedford, they love the town. This would be a potentially really good opportunity for them, and the cottages are being designed with that in mind.
Yeah, like 2 or 3 bedroom, smaller size house.
Right.
Yep.
I think they're all 2-bedroom. Are there some that are 3-bedroom?
I don't actually know. I mean, so we work on the zoning.
And actually, we'll have to go
granular.
It wasn't the big palatial kind of.
No, exactly.
They're not palatial.
Oh no, you're correct,
right,
because some of those existing units are 3 bedrooms, but they're
right,
very. If anyone went in and toured them, they're very small,
right,
bedrooms.
And actually, that brings up a really important point too, because this actually isn't even the end of the process. The end of the process would be when, hopefully, the zoning passes, and then they come back to the planning board with a site plan, and we do a site plan review, and they ask for a special permit. That's when we'd look into the actual spacing of the houses, the construction of the houses, you know, what the houses look like. Now, at town meeting, you'll see some of that presented, but it's important to understand that's a notional plan that could be executed based upon the current zoning. So the only thing that's really set right now are the existing houses. The new houses, this developer certainly has a plan, but that could be changed. We could get, it hasn't all been vetted with police, fire, conservation, so you'll see a notional plan, but really it's the zoning that we're focusing on in town meeting.
Okay. Terrific.
There you go.
And the other...
It's open for more input, basically. Yeah, good.
Yeah,
right, because if somebody still wants to comment on the process, they want to comment on the mix of houses, the distribution of houses, they're certainly very welcome to participate in the special permit process.
There Perfect. You go. And something that happened just tonight, we set a date, I believe, for Amy Lloyd and Jeff Cohen to come and talk to Bedford Television about the Great Road Zoning Project.
Excellent.
Which there is a fabulous FAQ out that runs 5 pages.
Wow.
every possible permutation is out there. It's on the town website, and we'll have it in the Citizen. But you guys have been doing some work.
Yes, so this is something that we are taking a lot of pride in. It's been an 18-month effort that we sought funding from town meeting to help kick off the study. And as Margot mentioned, it really is a generational type thing. We really want to set a blueprint for how the Great Road will evolve over time. And let's make no mistake about it, it will evolve. We just want to make sure that it evolves in a way that's consistent with the character of the town, that's amenable to the residents of the town and expressed as what we really want as a town. So that's why we've spent a lot of time taking input, understanding what people want, having a couple of major public sessions, several other public hearings, and now we're in kind of the advertising phase. But not to... I don't want to repeat too much what I said last month, but I know last month I really stressed the point that this is a complicated piece of legislation, article. So please come to town meeting, absolutely, and we'd love to have your support for it. But please also understand that if you come to town meeting and read it all there, it's unlikely you'll pick up on all the nuances of it. So there'll be a lot of communications. I certainly would advocate people watch that show with Amy and Jeff, but there'll be other communications in the paper. There's a frequently asked questions that's going to go in. And those are great ways in really understanding what's really going into this. Because we'd really like for people to come to town meeting and as best as we can understand what we're trying to do, why this is so important. And I'm really excited for where this is going to go. And another point I just want to make while I'm thinking about it, a lot of this is about not so much the traditional zoning about dimensions and setbacks and heights, although that's certainly in there, but a lot of it is about the look and feel and the architectural aesthetics of this as well. And that's going a bit beyond what we normally do for zoning.
Yeah.
Because it is such a public facing street. It's so important to the town. It's kind of the town's living room, effectively. It's what people see. So I know there have been some people that have complained in the past about recent developments and maybe a blank type of a look. And we're hearing those. We're not happy about the blank type of look either. And the fact of the matter is, under current zoning, there's really nothing we can do about that other than advise. I mean, we can really beg the developer to do something better than that, but we don't have any legal standing for that. So with this zoning package and the design standards, we can not only steer developers towards what is something that's been pleasing or judged pleasing to this town, but we have some teeth when we say, make a recommendation, you know, we want to have interesting looking buildings. We want to have buildings that reflect the character of the town. So that's why it's so important. A lot of the buildings that are on the Great Road now are buildings that are essentially ripe for development. They've existed for decades, back to the 50s or so. So one way or the other, they're going to be redeveloped. But let's make sure that we, as a town, control that process and make sure that it goes forward in a way that we really So 10 years from now, 20 years from now, we're really pleased with the outcome of it.
Generation.
That is wonderful. In our culture, we kind of take that for granted and just say, oh yeah, that will happen that way. But in fact, when I was working in Nepal, and a friend of mine, property next door was a house, it suddenly became a metal shop. And there was no zoning at all. They didn't even have the concept of zoning. And so I think for our town to be thinking, not in terms just of zoning, but in terms of the the ethics of the whole, the ethical features of the whole thing, this is super. Yeah, keep up the good work.
Thank you.
Speaking of generations.
Oh yeah, we got the future generations.
The future generations and Davis School.
It's so exciting to see how it's all come together. We've worked so closely with various folks in town, with the architects, and we keep tweaking and learning. Just last night, the superintendent met with folks both in Lane and folks that live in the neighborhood or near Davis School to talk a little bit more about the projects, because folks, in addition to their children attending the schools, also live in close proximity and are very interested in what this is all going to look like. But town meeting will be very exciting to see, again, the next step taken as we look forward to both renovating and adding on to the Davis School. I think of the two points. I still think of it as a new school because my daughter went to kindergarten there, but she works at the State House. And I love the point when we're constantly asked about our projections and, you know, what's it going to look like 10 years out? And the quip is that the parents of Davis School students haven't met yet. So it's very hard to sort of plan for that. But it's exciting and it's wonderful to see the support in the town. In the fall, it was unanimous. We know folks will come and hear more and learn more, and they can also look online on the school's website. There'll be additional information, but we're very excited about it. There are other things going on in the schools as well. It's so tragic what happened in Parkland, and it has caused for discussions. Obviously, Bedford takes school security very seriously. We continue to follow the ALICE protocols, work closely. It's expected that many of the students will participate in a student-led walkout on March 14th. So we're taking steps to plan for that as well. Obviously, we encourage civil discussions and public participation, but there has to be some planning if every student's going to walk out of a school.
Is that in all schools?
I'm not sure if it's nationwide. I know it's in Massachusetts.
But all grades in Bedford?
No, I believe it's the high school.
Okay.
But they are discussing with all of the principals. And I'm not sure if it's nationwide or not. I should know that, but I don't. I assume it's going to be popular in some parts and maybe not so much in others. But we'll see, and we're planning for it accordingly. We also have Ed Camp coming up, which is a wonderful opportunity where teachers train other teachers in a variety of subjects. It's a really neat workshop. It's wildly popular. This year there'll be 80 different workshops going on while the teachers all go and some present, some learn, and it's been really well received, and it's exciting to see what they're doing this year. And then they're going to have a keynote speaker is Audrey Jackson, who was the 2016 Teacher of the Year in Massachusetts, and she's going to focus on social-emotional challenges.
When is that happening? What's the date on?
March 9th.
March 9th, all right.
Yeah, maybe you could head back. And again, the meetings went really well. There's other nice things going on in town. We have musicals coming up. They're doing this musical at the Bedford High School, March 14th, 15th, 16th, and the 16th and 17th. So it'd be nice for people to go to that. The Bedford Education Foundation had a wildly successful Mardi Gras event, raised more money than they've ever raised before, which will make it possible for teachers to then apply for grants to pay for interesting projects in the schools. We really, kudos to them. Yeah, we're
and
so
Tenacity
impressed.
Challenge is coming up.
Tenacity Challenge is coming up, which is really exciting as people get ready. And it's wonderful to see the students work so hard and be rewarded for it, and then to compete against other students from other schools. It's great. And I wish I could recall who the speaker is this year. But anyway, it's going to be very interesting. It's a very worthwhile endeavor. And then one last thing is this weekend, some of the juniors are presenting the history fair for the regional history fair.
Oh,
so
yeah.
We wish them luck. It's a lot of work.
Phew.
Yeah, that's going on.
Our town is just phenomenal, the way they really think ahead and the way the school, you know, when I was principal, they needed more space, put on a modular classroom. Yeah. You're looking at the whole school to accommodate this.
Well, you know, and it's only when you speak to folks in other communities
yeah.
and you see the commitment town-wide and the support for the schools. We're very, very fortunate.
Yeah.
And very, very smart to look at systemically rather than let's do this over here and something over here and another thing.
Yep. It was always school against school. Oh, I want this part and I want that part.
Not anymore.
Not anymore.
It's all a package.
So brilliant.
It's all a package.
Yep.
Thank you all.
Yes.
Unless somebody has something else to say.
No.
Have we run the wells dry? All the news is fit to print is out there?
The wells aren't dry, never dry in Bedford.
That's true.
But we're right on time.
There you go. So stick with us. We've got a few more things to talk about. We have Katie Penny coming to talk about Relay for Life and Mike Rosenberg to talk about HVAC and hats.
All with Anscombe Field.
That's right. So don't go away.
It's going to be good. Thank you very much.
Welcome back. Our guest in this segment is none other than Katie Penny, and she is going to talk to us about an event that's happening on May 19th, but you have to think about it now because you want to get teams ready to be in Relay for Life.
May 19th, I'm writing it down.
Okay, there you
okay.
go.
Got it. Katie.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you for coming to talk to us, and thank you for your support of Relay for Life.
Absolutely. This is a really important event to me. A lot of my family, or in my family, and then my friends' parents have all been touched by cancer. And my friend, one of my best friends, her dad has had multiple fights with cancer. And so in sixth grade now, she asked me to join her team, and I've just been doing it ever since.
And if I'm putting two and two together and coming up with four, I think that participation is very, very welcome.
Absolutely. This year, we're focusing really on involving the community, and we are trying to reach out to businesses and to reach out to not just the high schoolers and the middle schoolers, but truly everyone in the community, because it is a community event. And
there is no one in the town who has not been touched.
Absolutely, yeah.
At one level or another. So what kinds of things can we do to help you reach?
So this year our goal is $50,000, and
wow.
It's really large. But it's that large because we were actually, our event was discontinued by the American Cancer Society because we didn't raise enough money last year, and we were too small of an event for them to provide the care of a Relay for Life. And so we, as a committee, we got together and we decided to fight for it, and we talked to many executives in the American Cancer Society. And they eventually overturned that decision and are allowing us to have this year. But this year is so crucial because it determines whether or not we can continue in the future. So we're aiming for $50,000 to be sure that we can continue.
Do you have a history of how much you've raised in other years? Is that written somewhere?
It absolutely is. I don't know exactly. I know last year we only raised $26,000.
Oh, that's a lot!
But like previous years that I was on committee, I remember freshman year we raised over $45,000. Wow. So it's absolutely doable.
So you're doing well. Our Bedford High kids are good.
And organizations and projects have ebbs and flows. Like everybody is into it one year, and next year you couldn't.
That's true too.
You know. Put a bomb under them, or the firecracker in there.
Hey, but our students at Bedford High are the best.
They are indeed.
And taking on a project like this, so you're going for $50,000.
Yeah,
that is
congratulations.
I think you can make it. I got a feeling you might even exceed it. So, how about involving the public? Now, that you say have not emphasized that in the past, because quite frankly. I'm a cancer survivor, too.
Yeah.
And I would have gone to those, but I didn't know I was invited. I thought it was just high school kids.
Yeah. Since our committee is just high school students, we really have been just focusing on the high school and the middle school because that's where most committee members have the larger number of connections. And this year, we really took a step back and realized that we do have people of all ages come. We have family members, and we have college students returning, and we really haven't been doing enough to really spread how welcoming Relay for Life is to everyone of all ages and all backgrounds, and we really wanted to be able to let everyone know because there are so many cancer survivors in Bedford alone, and we want to include them in this.
I was on the impression this was like an all-day, all-night, all-day kind of an event.
So it's
does an old geezer like me have to stay sleep out on the high school track?
Yes, you do. It's
encouraged.
An air mattress, you'll be fine.
The opening ceremonies start at 4 p.m. on May 19th, and all of the ceremonies and very important things happen before 11 p.m.
at night.
Yep, okay. And that is when people who have not raised the $125, which is required to stay overnight, that's when everyone can leave, and you can also opt out. It's not mandatory if you raise over $125. You don't have to stay overnight. You can come for some of the day. You can come for the whole day. And the overnight is the really hard part, and it's mainly just like, it's mainly high school students that are walking the track.
And they walk the track all night long?
There are a decent amount of people that do. There are some kids that sleep, but...
But it's a relay. You can kind of sleep for a while and then...
The goal is to have one member of each Relay for Life team on the track at one time.
Wow, so you have to set up your team.
Yeah, there are some teacher teams that are really good, and they have like a scheduled time of like who's walking from when to when.
Oh, the teachers are out there too?
There are
I didn't know that. Oh, it's just crazy.
You're going to have to.
I'm going to have to come.
Shall you and I be a team? You and Jean and me? And
yes, let's do that.
Who else can we put on our team?
Oh, I'm sure there's got to be some people out there that might say, can we join your team?
I think we do that. We need you.
Yeah.
We need you. So we have a team now. So, it's very small, just the two of us.
So it's May 19th. That's a Saturday, a Friday, or what?
It's a Saturday.
It's a Saturday?
Yeah.
So we show up around 2 o'clock, 4 o'clock?
So to register...
This is the old Giza team.
Yeah, so to register your team...
I'm old, but I'm not a Giza.
Well, I'm the old Giza.
Oh, all right. I'm just old.
The opening ceremonies are at 4, but for teams, as a team, you'll get a like little area where you could set up a tent if you're staying overnight, or just like a table or chairs if you want to like set up a little campsite, and you're welcome to come around 2 o'clock to set up.
Okay.
I just want to be there at 4, so I get there at 4, what happens?
Well, but if 4 o'clock is good too, but the wonderful part is the candlelight.
Yes.
Yeah.
The luminaria.
That's good. So you've seen it before.
I have.
Yes.
Oh, geez. See, where have I been?
I have.
I'm useless.
Well, no, you're not useless.
Okay,
I have found my way there.
Oh, you're doing... Oh, you're an expert.
Well, I'm not an expert. Katie's the expert. the luminaria ceremony is remarkably moving.
So what time is that?
That is at 9 p.m., and it is supposed to symbolize the darkest part of a cancer patient's journey. And we shut off all the lights on the track, and we give glow sticks instead of candles because those blow out. And it's really moving. And this year we're having a... he graduated from Bedford High School last year, Jack Tomsicek. He's the key speaker. And it's really moving, and he's a cancer survivor himself.
Really?
And it's really a time to reflect on celebrating the cancer survivors that have won, but to also remember the cancer survivors and the cancer fighters who have lost their battle.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
It is amazing.
So Jack will be speaking around 9 o'clock?
Yes, the ceremony starts at 9. And what's really moving is after he speaks and he shares his story, what we ask is we'll say, like, everyone who is a cancer survivor, light your glow stick. And then everyone cracks, and there's certain experiences like that. And after, like, all of the experiences have been gone through, everyone has their glow stick, and we all take a silent lap together around the track.
Wow. Yeah, it is is incredibly moving. Yeah. Incredibly moving. And the year that I was there for all of that, there was a team of people who on the visitor bleachers took Luminaria and spelled out hope.
Oh, yes,
wow.
We do that every year.
I'll start crying.
Oh, yeah, you do.
It's amazing.
You do.
And oh, man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we take the Luminaria bags, and people have a chance to decorate them for whatever they feel they would like to put on the bag, and we line the decorated ones around the track,
so
you're taking a lap, you can see what people... Yeah. wanted to share.
And that's a little bit of a fundraiser as well. You can, if you aren't doing a team, if you aren't doing anything else, you can
Oh, so you like
support a luminaria?
So you could buy a luminaria?
Yes, you can buy a luminaria.
What do they cost?
They, for the white bags, they're $10. We have purple and white bags that are $15, and then gold bags that have little star cutouts that are $20.
Wow, okay.
Splendid.
So we could get a friend who want to buy a luminaria bag. Like, well, now, we decorate it? Was that part of the
You can decorate them, yeah.
Yeah.
So go ahead.
I was just going to say, you know, even if you can't be there on the 19th, you can buy a luminaria.
And somebody will put it out for you.
Yeah.
I mean, if I was going to do that, I'll be happy to collect some luminaries and make sure they're there.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. So 4 o'clock is the opening ceremony.
Yes.
What happens after that?
After the opening ceremony, it really is a lively event. And in the past couple of years, I was entertainment and activities lead. So I got to schedule the event. And there's different games and activities. And this year, our theme is superheroes. So we're doing a bunch of different games based on the superhero theme.
So while
Very big this year.
So while people playing games, there's still a relay person walking all the time?
Yes, there is. And there's so many different things going on, and we have a DJ playing music, and we have different performers come. Like, we'll have dance jam classes and Zumba classes to get people up and moving who aren't walking on the track.
So people come in and set
then
up all
you
that.
Bring a picnic?
Yeah.
Dinner.
Okay, so you get to bring your own food for lunch?
Yes.
Okay, so our snack
we
or
do,
dinner.
We do, for cancer survivors, we have a survivor tent, and at the opening ceremonies, we have all the survivors and caregivers take a lap together, the very first lap of the event.
Oh, so at 4 o'clock?
At 4 o'clock.
I get my special lap. I'll be there for that.
And so
but
then,
I want to be there for the luminaria lap, too.
Yeah, okay. And then after the cancer survivors and caregivers take their lap together, we invite them to the tent, and we have a lunch for them, and we have like a way to celebrate their fight.
I think I'm right on this. The reason it goes overnight, it ends at 6 o'clock in the morning.
Okay.
That you go down into the very darkest times. And then you come back out at the end when
the
sun comes up.
Yeah. It's meant to symbolize a cancer patient's journey.
Oh, it's a bad journey.
Yeah.
I'm gonna say something about my cancer thing.
Absolutely.
I was really at the bottom of that journey. And they said, if we don't get it this time, you only have a 30% chance of living. And I go, oh, geez, I said, well, try hard. But that next week, I was driving for Air Lifeline. And I met a young child at Hanscom Field to take him to Children's Hospital for their treatment. And he was this second grader, no hair, because she was undergoing the chemo and the things, in a wheelchair. And I said to myself, I'm worried about me. She was just like one of my students at Davis School. And I says, I'm going to spend all my energy to worry about her from now on. And I ended up signing up for the PanMash Challenge, which is another fundraiser for the for Dana-Farber Institute and the Jimmy Fund, but I signed up to do the 200-mile bike ride. I thought it was only 20 miles. I misread it.
Uh-oh.
But, you know, I said, oh, geez, I told her I was going to do the PanMash Challenge. And I started training, and I rode the whole 200 miles.
And that was how many years ago?
Oh, that was at least 15 years ago, because I did it for 10 years. Both my wife, Jean, and I did it for 10 years. But the thing is, it was the journey, yes, you went to the deepest part, but then you found a reason to get up and say, wait a minute, there's something more than me involved with this. We got to solve cancer for everyone.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what you're doing. This is so darn good. Katie, I'm impressed with
so, Katie,
what
how
you're
do
doing.
How do people who are watching this get in touch with you? Do you have a website?
We do. You can just Google Bedford MA Relay for Life.
Okay.
And it takes you to our events webpage, and there's multiple things you can do. You can just create make a donation. You can sign up as an individual, or you can create a team. And it also gives like more information about Relay for Life and what our event does.
Yeah. So. Okay. So maybe we can actually put this right on the.
I think we'll be able to do that
on the TV screen.
We'll be able to do that.
Yeah. Let's encourage everybody to sign up.
Amen.
Okay, and be there on May 19th, which is a Saturday.
Saturday.
Yeah.
Okay, so and that's at 4 o'clock in the afternoon on a Saturday. So you walk all night long Saturday, and Sunday morning it's finally over.
Yeah. It's 6 o'clock in the morning.
But folkies just like me don't have to walk all night long.
Nope.
Only for part of it.
I'll do my one lap for sure, but I think we can do more. I'm not doing the 200-mile thing anymore.
We'll work on you on that one. Katie, thank you very much for doing this, and thank you for coming to talk about all of this with us. And come on, Bedford, we need $50,000 if all of us participate. It isn't going to be that big a deal for any one of us individually to support this initiative.
Bedford High School in the Relay for Life.
Amen. This is the how many F year that the relay?
This is the 13th.
13th. Lucky 13.
We're going to make it go on for a long time. Katie, thank you so much
thank
for rescuing
for
this whole thing.
There you go. We'll be back to talk about Hanscom Field. Don't go away.
Great. Thank you.
Our guest in this segment is none other than Mike Rosenberg, who is known as many different kinds of things. But tonight we're going to talk about Hanscom Field and Massport through the lens of the Hanscom Field Advisory Committee and the Hanscom Area Town Study. Mm-hmm. And Mike is chair of both. And how are they different? How are they alike? Excuse me.
First of all, I want to pay tribute to a mentor, the late Gordon Feltman, who was my predecessor as selectman 10 years ago. And he taught me the importance of being involved at the regional level. We have a lot of different initiatives that are regional, but two of the oldest and most important have to do with the airport. Both of these organizations were established through state law. The Hanscom Field Advisory Commission, we call it HVAC, is composed not only of one representative from the four towns contiguous to the airfield, but also of a number of representatives of other groups that are affected by the policies of the Port Authority in running the airport, including pilots.
Oh, wow.
And the longtime representative of the pilots is one of our most dedicated members is Tom Hirsch, who lives in Bedford. Different other installations at the airport, the FBOs. So it's more than just the government bodies. It's also other constituencies that are affected. And we talk only about air traffic, noise, projects in and around the airport. And it's a conversation with representatives of the Port Authority. The Hanscom representatives that represent Massport are usually the operations manager and at times the airport manager herself. And after 10 years, I can say that we have really a collegial relationship with these people. It wasn't always like that.
No, I was on it when it was very different.
Wow.
Years ago.
But a lot of it has to do with the policies and transparency that was promoted through the current CEO of Massport, Dr. Glynn, and that's a transition point for me, because at our next meeting of the Hanscom Area Towns Committee, Dr. Glynn will be our featured guest and will be presenting his annual report about all of the Port Authority's activities and focusing on Hanscom wherever it's appropriate. So there is some overlap between HVAC and the Hanscom Area Towns Committee, which is known as HATS, because it originally, 35 years ago, was set up as a traffic committee, Hanscom Area Traffic Study. And then it became Hanscom Area Towns Selectmen. The composition of HATS is one selectman and one planning board and one conservation commission representative from each of the three contiguous towns, plus an at-large representative. I think we have a vacancy for that now. And so each of the four contiguous towns has four, although sometimes we let Lincoln off the hook because they have a smaller population base. And we talk about subjects that are of interest to all of us, not necessarily related to either the airfield or the Air Force Base, although there is participation each month from representatives of Massport and the Air Force and the National Park. But sometimes we talk about things like, well, how are things going with your municipal efforts to offset OPEB expenditures? Or
what's OPEB?
You know, what they call other post-employment benefits, the health insurance for retired employees, which is
a very big deal.
It's an unfunded liability that runs into millions of dollars, and some towns are addressing it and some aren't. Or like our last meeting, we talked about energy initiatives, net zero, efforts for new construction to be
LEED certified, kinds of things.
All of those subjects. Some of the most interesting information came from the Air Force base, which is incredibly forward thinking in terms of energy efficiency. All of their new construction is at the highest level.
Wow.
And there's a lot of it going on at Hanscom. The month before that, we shared stories about efforts to control traffic and ways to improve regional traffic services that would take off some of the vehicular pressure. Incidentally, it took me 12 minutes to get here from Loomis Street in a car.
Yeah.
It would have been about 4 minutes on foot. So the HATS committee's meetings are much broader and more interesting in terms of, you know, if you wanted to say, well, there's nothing on TV tonight, I think I'll go to the HATS meeting. There's just a lot more meat there, because in addition to a focus at each meeting, we also take turns reporting on highlights in our own towns, you know, different things that are going on, things we can all learn from. And then we, again, as I said, we hear from our neighbors in the military, our neighbors in Massport, and our neighbors at the Minuteman National Park. And usually the park superintendent or his or her representative attends. And we talk about transportation projects that directly or indirectly affect all of us. When Route 2 was under construction, that was a big headliner. And that only peripherally affected us in Bedford, but it was still important to know about it. And that includes bike path construction.
Oh, right. And the trails, too, because I know that we talked to them on the trails committee.
But over the years, we've talked about agriculture in the four towns. We have periodic visits from our representatives and senators.
Yep.
We almost got Catherine Clark to come to one of our meetings, but she got snowed in Washington. But that's the closest we've ever had to a celebrity of that stature. But many times we have representatives of the congressional offices. So those each group meets monthly.
So it's a very high-level committee, then.
And there is some overlap, as you could see from my mention of Tom Glynn in both contexts. But the HVAC meetings focus on specific details about noise monitoring, construction projects. There is a major construction project going on coming up that will affect Bedford. The request for proposals has just been issued for construction of over 100,000 feet of hangar space right off Hartwell Road, between Instrumentation Labs and the old abandoned, what they called the Raytheon, the Navy hangars.
Mm-hmm.
There used to be, old-timers will remember, even recent old-timers will remember when the military had
drones,
people living in trailers.
On both
sides of the street.
Yep.
And on one side, that became the edge.
Mm-hmm.
And the trailers on the other side were taken away, and that's going to be the site of these new storage facilities. So that'll be
And are they going to remodel the hangars?
That's a separate question, and that's more of a long range thing that Massport's working on right now. Those hangars are owned by the Navy.
Mm-hmm.
And they're over 50 years old, so they are.
There's some question about
it.
There's some question about it. And it's kind of ironic because I think they're an eyesore.
They would make the most wonderful art center.
Well, they would. Yeah. I wouldn't give up on that idea.
Yeah.
I'm not.
But in the meantime, they're moving ahead with new construction. Now, this is an interesting point that we heard from the Port Authority people, and I think I don't know if it can be proven mathematically, but this is what they're saying. The construction of new storage space, these hangars, is actually going to reduce aircraft volume for takeoff and landing. Because now, several times a day, corporate jets land at Hanscom, drop off executives, And then there's nowhere to put the planes for the night. So they take off and go to, I don't know, Bradley
Oswego or
anywhere,
wherever.
You know,
yeah.
You know, it doesn't take very long, wherever they have to go. And then the next day they come back, pick up the executive again, and take off for the next corporate trip. When these hangars are open, they'll be able to drop somebody off, park in the hangar and spend the night somewhere, maybe
eat at Bedford hotels.
Oh my, does that mean there will be a hotel at Hanscom?
Right. Well, no, that's not, at one time there was discussion of that, but we know there's going to be a new hotel in Crosby Drive, but that's another issue of Bedford Common.
So Mike, let me get this, to the rest of people, you know, listening to this program, there's the military of Hanscom Field, then there's the
Massport.
Is there another section or
there's so much confusion about that. The military owned Hanscom Field until 1973 when they turned it over to the Port Authority
to run as the
number one general aviation airport in New England.
Oh.
So the military base is there, but it has no aircraft. Aircraft that come and go are Air Force
this
aircraft,
like
but they're not attached to Hanscom. Hanscom Air Force Base is a bunch of buildings and other installations and facilities. The runway and the airfield is civil.
All Massport.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And,
okay.
And among the other projects they're building, there's a new fire station.
Well, how about the civil air terminal? That comes under Massport?
That's Massport. That's why they call it civil.
It's full. It has a TSA. You can go in and you can X-ray baggage, and you know if somebody is.
No, there's no lines because
I know.
There's no commercial service.
Yeah.
Now under the Massport's master plan, they could have commercial service of up to 60 passengers a day, but there are no prospects for that. And at the end of every HVAC meeting, somebody asks two questions. Have there been any increase for commercial service, and have there been any increase for passenger service, and you know, passenger or delivery? And year after year, it's no and no. And we just monitor that very closely because we know how important that is to the area residents.
Right.
We have a open forum for people who have noise complaints. We had somebody just at last week's meeting who was very unhappy about what she lives on Hartwell Road, and she was very unhappy about what she said were engines revving on the runway. Of course, we used to have that all the time when we had the squadron here, but that was 50 years ago. Now, that's not supposed to happen. And the Massport representative said, I'm going to check it out, and we're going to stop it. They're not supposed to do that. We can't stop aircraft from coming and going at night. That's an FAA rule. You can't shut down at night. But the Massport does charge a lot of money for aircraft that come and go between 11 and 7.
How can they tell who's coming and going? Is there someone in the tower
all
night?
Yeah, there's. There has to be.
just and, asking.
And they have to, when they come between 11 and 7, and that includes the Bruins and the Celtics when they have a late game.
Yeah, they come in and out, right? Yeah. Go out.
They have to. They have to pay, you know, several hundred dollars for each landing. Now the town doesn't benefit from that. Massport gets the money, but the town does get a big chunk of money from the jet fuel tax. That's many thousand dollars that goes to the four towns. So there is a revenue source there for Bedford.
Well, that's good to know.
I think they're trying to be good neighbors.
I think so,
We're trying to be good neighbors. We're trying to have open communication. And this new project that's coming up with the hangar construction will have some limited impact on some residences, as you know, like any building project would. And then it'll be done. But there's an environmental process. There'll be public meetings about it. Nothing's going to happen for several months.
Right. And the first public meeting is, now I'm forgetting the date, but it's like the 14th or the 24th of March. It's early in March.
Yeah, I think that's mainly for people who want to bid on the job.
Or residents, I think.
I'm going to find out just how.
Yeah.
Watch the Bedford Citizen. You'll have a little.
We're going to have the story tomorrow, but that doesn't mean anything to you because tomorrow is a long way past by the time you see this.
But there will be more information about
scheduling.
There
will be more
events.
Information. And
This is really cool. Mike, really, this is great.
Yeah, sorry, I can't seem to stop gushing about it.
Well, hey, listen, there have been times when things haven't gone so well, and it is good to hear a partisan speak for the way
it's
they
can. It's an honor and a responsibility to do this, and it's I look forward to these meetings and to seeing people who, as we work together, because I think certainly the military and Massapartout, those are local resources. They make a lot of noise sometimes.
Yeah, but they want to listen too. I've called them on the phone to complain once about things, and they got right back, and they were very positive.
Well, and so, when the two F-16s took off the other day, hi, here we are. We got to the end of the runway. We go up. They made
it was fun.
Remarkable amount of noise.
It's like an air show at 6 in the morning.
Afterburners.
Yeah. Right, exactly. And so I called Hanscom, and I called Massport. And the Massport people got in touch with somebody at, I can't remember, a naval base, or naval installation in Virginia. And they got back to me, and we had the whole story. And then I got a written report from HVAC, from Massport.
If anybody has questions or complaints, anytime, feel free to contact me. I really like the opportunity to be the liaison.
Right. Mike, we really thank you for this above and beyond the call of duty service to our town.
Well, it is good to get it out. And so one of the meetings is in Lincoln and the other is at the airport. Are they both in the same week of the year or week of the month?
HVAC meets on the third Tuesday of every month on the third floor of the Civil Air Terminal. HATS has been meeting on the fourth Thursday of every month in the Lincoln Town offices. But the next chairman is going to be from Lexington. She's going to take over in April, and she may prefer to move the meetings to Lexington.
Yeah.
But they'll be posted in Bedford in any case.
All right.
There will be no HATS meeting in March because we all have town meeting at the end of March.
There you go. Right.
Thank you very much,
Mike. Thank you very much. It is ours as well. And that's it for us for March. So we trust that by you'll be getting to town meeting. And we will see you there. And vote. Don't forget to vote. There aren't any contested races this month or this year, but that doesn't mean it's not an important thing to get out and
cast
your ballot.
You need to practice.
There you go. There you go.
Thank you very much for tuning in. And I'd like to thank some of our high school students that are working on this. Mike in grade 10, and we had Evan here in grade 7. So we have a lot of students.
And Al Fay.
And Al is doing the camera.
There you go. We have Steve
out there, and Greg is always keeping an eye on us all.
There you go.
So thank you all very much.
Thanks, Mike. Thanks, Mike, everybody.
Thank you.
We say goodnight now. Goodnight.
Oh, sure.
Thank you.